Hello and welcome to Physio Classroom. In our effort to include more number of topics related to physiotherapy education, today we are starting a brand new series related to palpatory techniques, which we can utilize in the assessment and treatment of patients for a variety of disorders. In today's video, we are going to cover the palpation for four important structures, which are the external occipital protuberance, suboccipital fossa, ligamentum nuchae, and C2 spinous process. Now, before we start demonstrating the palpation of these four structures, let's just quickly cover few important points related to them. The external occipital protuberance is present in the posterior inferior part of the skull near the middle of the squamous part of the occipital bone. It serves as the insertion point for the trapezius muscle as well as the ligamentum nuchae. The highest point of this external occipital protuberance is known as the enion. Tenderness to palpation at the level of external occipital protuberance can be one of the important signs to confirm tension headaches as well as the cervicogenic headaches. Palpation of the suboccipital fossa is again very important as it serves as the landmark to palpate and localize the ligamentum nuchae as well as the C2 spinous process. Ligamentum nuchae is the ligament of the back of the neck. It is the continuation of the supraspinous ligament and it extends from the C7 vertebra to the external occipital protuberance. Ligamentum nuchae serves as the attachment for splenius capitis muscle and trapezius muscle. Due to its location in the posterior part of the neck, it also serves to restrict the flexion movement of the cervical spine. This ligament can undergo a lot of creep and hysteresis in chronic neck pain patients. And so palpating this ligament enables the therapist to deliver specific soft tissue manipulation technique. Similarly, C2 spinous process palpation can be utilized in the treatment of cervicogenic headaches and neck pains. So let's start practically demonstrating these palpatory techniques one by one. It is recommended to position the patient in neutral, unsupported sitting before beginning with the cervical spine palpation. The therapist should next stand beside the patient and take control over the patient's head position by placing a flattened hand on the top of the head. The therapist should position the cervical spine in neutral by not allowing the head to be shifted forward or backwards in relation to the trunk. This can be ensured by observing that the occiput and the upper thoracic spine are found in the same plane. The therapist now begins with the occiput palpation by placing the finger pads of the second and third finger flatly over the occiput. Using slightly circular motion, the therapist searches for the raised part of the occiput that corresponds to the dimensions and shape of a well-developed tubercle, the external occipital protuberance. The ligamentum nuchae attaches firmly to this point. After palpating the external occipital protuberance, the therapist now proceeds towards palpation of suboccipital fossa and ligamentum nuchae. The therapist now, while using the pad of the index finger, moves inferiorly while repeatedly pressing against the occipital bone during this process. When the last point of bony contact with the occiput is felt, the palpating index finger pad will now be located in a large fossa approximately 1 cm in size, which is bordered by a variety of structures. This will be the suboccipital fossa. The ligamentum nuchae, which forms the anterior boundary of the suboccipital fossa can be palpated at this point. The therapist can feel an extremely elastic form of resistance when applying posterior-anterior pressure using the finger pad. The therapist can more clearly feel the increase and decrease in tension in the ligamentum nuchae by moving the cervical spine into extensive flexion and extension respectively. During active cervical spine extension, the therapist can feel the tense muscle bellies of both semispinalis capitis muscle on the right and left side of the suboccipital fossa. To palpate the C2 spinous process, the cervical spine is again placed in a neutral position and the palpating finger positioned in the suboccipital fossa is pushed inferiorly. The hard bony resistance of the C2 spinous process can be felt immediately. The index finger or the thumb can now be used to palpate the posterior aspect of the asymmetrical bifurcated spinous process of C2 vertebra. So that was all about the first video on palpatory techniques for the cervical spine. In our next video in the palpation series, we will be demonstrating the palpatory technique to differentiate the C7 spinous process from T1 and from C6, that is the cervicothoracic junction palpation. As well as we will also be demonstrating the palpatory techniques for the cervical facet joints, which are known as the zygoapophyseal joints. Till then, keep learning, keep sharing, and stay connected.